Welcome back to Tilling the Soil. I am your host, Mr. Jason. Thank you for joining me once again, and I'd love to see you showed up to view this week's installment. So you can type the names of those watching in the comments below, and at the end, I'd love to read your answers to Pastor Kevin's Question from Kids segment. And for tonight's program, we're going to be jumping around and covering a little bit more than usual. So for those curious about the scripture we'll be in, we'll be studying from Galatians chapter 4, John chapter 2, 1 Corinthians chapter 5, Hebrews chapter 10, and finally Luke chapter 23. But first things first, let's begin in prayer. Dear Lord, thank you so much for allowing us to gather like this again. Gather like this as our digital small group on a Monday night. Thank you so much for a wonderful Resurrection Sunday, Lord. A time spent with family and church family. And just an amazing time to be together and just soaking in the joy and the blessings that come from having you as our Savior. So Lord, please open our hearts to the lesson that you have laid on me to deliver here tonight, and just help us to take it in and move through with this lesson for the rest of our week, Lord. And I pray these things in the name of your son, Jesus. Amen. Now it's time for the Bible verse. The last week for this verse before we start a new unit next week. The next day, John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, "Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." John 1:29. This unit's memory verse speaks to the redemption of mankind from the curse of sin through the merciful and gracious gift of salvation offered to us by the sacrifice of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. How he is the Lamb of God, the flawless, spotless Lamb, to not only cover our sins for a year like the sacrifices of the law allowed, but to blot out, to clean us of our sins and clothe us in Christ's righteousness, his goodness for all time. So for tonight's verse lesson, I want to continue in Paul's letter to the Christians of the Galatia area as we try to deepen our understanding of Jesus being the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world by studying about humanity being as slaves until God sent his Son to reunite us fully with him. So let's begin tonight's program in Galatians chapter 4, verses 1 through 7. Think of it this way. If a father dies and leaves an inheritance for his young children, those children are not much better off than slaves until they grow up. Even though they actually own everything their father had, they have to obey their guardians until they reach whatever age their father set. So first thing to recognize right off the bat with this is that Paul is referencing the Roman custom of a boy being considered a man, because in both the Greek and Hebrew cultures, there is a set age at which a boy is considered a man. But in Rome, a boy wasn't considered a man until his father made that decision for him. So here is Paul is laying out an interesting point. That if a wealthy father were to pass away while his children were young, those children, while incredibly wealthy themselves, wouldn't have the power to do what they wanted with those riches. Those children would still be at the mercy of the decisions and instructions of the guardians, the caretakers, placed over the children by their deceased father. Those children, though wealthy, would have to be just as obedient to those guardians and caretakers as they would have been to their father. And in that regard, children are very much the slaves of their parents, bondservants of their parents. Children are to be obedient and honoring of their parents just as slaves are to their masters. Doing as asked when asked, just as we Christians are to be to Christ himself. And that's the part of this that our culture misses the mark so badly on. So often we'll hear of someone walking away from their faith to join the world, and they claim they've freed themselves from the chains of religion, that they can finally do everything they ever wanted to do. But the truth they miss so horribly is the simplest of truths, that we all have to be chained to something. We are all slaves to something. All those people did was leap out of the hand of Christ and chain themselves to sinfulness and the wages that come with it. By being chained to our faith, by being chained to Christ, we are the ones who are free, truly free, because this tainted, sin-filled world isn't all there is. And by being chained to the Son, we get the freedom to enjoy what comes next, eternity in the glorious presence of God. And that's the way it was with us before Christ came. We were like children. We were slaves to the basic spiritual principles of this world. Here Paul is telling the Christians in Galatia, which was an area, not a city, Paul was telling those Christians that they were being influenced by the Jewish people around them, that like the wealthy heirs who were essentially slaves to their guardians until they come of age, these people were slaves to the basic spiritual principles of the world. That they were slaves to the most basic principles of this world, principles like cause and effect, or that actions have consequences, and in a way, to the law. And like the children of Paul's example, the Jewish people were bondservants to the guardianship of the law. They had the law to keep them on the correct path, to instruct them and show them how to act and behave properly. But the problem all these basic principles get into is the idea that we, as people groups and as even individuals, get what we deserve. If we're good, good things happen. If we're bad, bad things happen. And Paul's using this idea to show the readers of his letter that God has a better way in mind, a way to avoid getting what we as sinners, all of us, deserve. God had the best way, grace, the undeserved gift of salvation that he so freely gives to us. So when the right time came, God sent his Son, born of a woman, subject to the law. God sent him to buy freedom for us who were slaves to the law, so that he could adopt us as his very own children. That undeserved gift of salvation came in the form of his very own Son, Jesus. God sent Jesus, subject to the law, as the only one capable of wholly observing the law to perfection, to buy our freedom, to pay the debt we had in sin, to buy our way out of the slavery of the law by putting an end to the system of sacrifices, by being that one final sin offering. Just so we could be reunited with the Father, just so a narrow path could be opened to allow us to turn from the punishment we deserve and return home to live in the presence of the Father, our Father as his children and not just his creation. And because we are his children, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, prompting us to call out, Abba, Father. Now you are no longer a slave, but God's own child. And since you are his child, God has made you his heir. The Lamb of God who came to take away the sin of the world. Jesus didn't come to remove sinfulness from the world. Sin still exists and will continue to exist as long as this earth remains, until the time of the new heaven and new earth. But he came to take those basic principles from us. Well, or more or less, he came to make them obsolete. He came to put the rest, the idea that we get what we deserve. Because no man, not one, is actually good, none but God. and we needn't receive what we do actually deserve. We needn't receive the wages of our sinfulness, because Jesus removed the basic principles and replaced them with the grace of all for all who believe. He came to unite us once again with the Father who so loved us that his only begotten Son was sent to blot out our sins, to pay our debt. See, because debts aren't forgiven. They're always paid one way or another. And in this instance, the debt was paid by the Son of God. And because of that, we are heirs to the kingdom of God. And because of that, we should live out our days as bondservants to the one who brought us grace, who brought us mercy, who brought us life everlasting. We should joyfully act as bondservants for Christ, who is the Lamb of God, who has willingly paid the debt for our sin. So now, let's get loosened up a bit before we head into the main Bible video by listening and moving along to our Bible verse song with Miss Bella. And now, since everyone's loose, let's get to this week's Bible video.
God first gave the Israelites his law through Moses so that they could understand that God is holy. The law showed that people are sinners. The law could not save the people, but it was like a shadow, hinting at something greater. Under the law, the people offered sacrifices for their sins, but they were still guilty. It is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins.
Jesus came to be the ultimate sacrifice for sin. He came to do God's plan, ending the old way of sacrifices by offering himself as the perfect sacrifice, once and for all.
Under the law, the priests stood day after day, offering the same sacrifices, but those sacrifices never took away sins. But Jesus came to offer himself one time. Then he sat down at the right hand of God. With one sacrifice, Jesus takes away the sin of everyone who trusts in him.
The Lord said, "I will never again remember their sins and the wrong things they have done." Because God forgives our sin, we no longer need to make a sacrifice to pay for sins.
Because all of this is true, God calls us to live in a way that honors him. He invites us to come to him with boldness and without fear. Jesus' blood has made the way for us to have hearts that are clean and without guilt. Jesus makes us pure when we have faith in him. He gives us hope, and we can tell the whole world about it. We can trust him to do all that he has promised.
We can help one another do what is right by loving others and doing good works. We can meet together and encourage one another because one day, Jesus will come again.
Jesus came to be the sacrifice for sin. He lived a sinless life, died on the cross, and rose from the dead. In him, we have complete forgiveness once and for all.
This week's Bible video covers Jesus being the ultimate sacrifice. So for tonight's lesson, let's begin in John chapter 2, verses 13 through 22. It was nearly time for the Jewish Passover celebration, so Jesus went to Jerusalem. Now, while the Bible video covered some scripture from chapter 10 of the letter we know as Hebrews, for tonight we're going to begin in John chapter 2. And in this portion of John, we come to another moment of Jesus traveling to the city of Jerusalem to celebrate Passover, the festival and feast day the Jewish people would observe in remembrance of the night the Lord passed over the houses of the Israelite slaves in Egypt as the 10th and final plague of the Lord was carried out on all of the firstborn children living in Egypt. And observance, this was a celebration that was observed by the Jewish people by law. It was a day commanded by the Lord for the Jewish people, written in the law of Moses, that you had to celebrate it as a remembrance of what he had done. So Jesus, being perfectly obedient to the law of Moses and the Father, made his way to Jerusalem once again. In the temple area, he saw merchants selling cattle, sheep, and doves for sacrifices. He also saw dealers at tables exchanging foreign money. It's estimated that around 2 million or so Jewish people would make their way through Jerusalem during the time of Passover. And seeing as there was a temple tax required for all who came to worship the Lord during Passover, and the Jewish people would be coming from all over the nation, they would need to exchange the coins they had from the other regions, the other often pagan idol worshiping areas they did business in. So these people would have to exchange the coins that had pagan idols lots of times carved in them and engraved in them for the temple's own currency, the temple's own coins. In addition to the money changing, the merchants of the temple were selling animals to the visiting Jewish people for sacrifices and making a lot of money for themselves by doing so. And this angered Jesus. Now, I know this goes against the ideas of Jesus that the culture around us and false teachers like to portray, that Jesus was never angry. He was just a happy-go-lucky, nice teacher who spread peace and love everywhere he went. Now, he did love everyone, but love takes many forms, and sometimes the kind of love required is tough love. Jesus was angry. He was about to show some tough love. But he wasn't out of control angry. He was righteously angry. Jesus made a whip from some ropes and chased them all out of the temple. He drove out the sheep and cattle, scattered the money changers' coins over the floor, and turned over their tables. See, Jesus didn't just snap and lose it. He didn't lose his sense of self-control, which is what anger normally is. It's a lack of self-control when we become emotional. But, you know, we all have unfortunately fallen into that at some point. But that's not what happened with Jesus. Jesus became righteously angered. And righteous anger is an anger that can only truly be credited to God, as he is the only one capable of righteousness. God is the only one good, truly good, and God is the only one perfect and perfectly just. So as the creator of all things, including morality, right from wrong, only he can be righteous and righteously angry and be morally just. And in this moment, the Lord, having seen the sinfulness of the merchants at the temple, went out and made himself a whip of interwoven ropes, basically tied them all together, and then proceeded to re-enter the temple area and drive out the merchants and animals, flipping over tables and pouring money out everywhere. Then going over to the people who sold doves, he told them, "Get these things out of here. Stop turning my father's house into a marketplace." Then his disciples remembered this prophecy from the scriptures: "Passion for God's house will consume me." This had to have been a shock to everyone in the temple area. This was the way they chose to do business. This is what the Jewish religious leaders chose to allow in the temple area that they controlled. Even Jesus' disciples themselves had to have been shocked to see the actions and behavior of Jesus. That is, until they remembered Psalm 69:9, or more than likely until God saw to place Psalm 69:9 on their hearts. "Because zeal for your house has eaten me up, and the reproaches of those who reproach you have fallen on me." See, it wasn't just that the religious leaders allowed the merchants to turn God's temple into a marketplace. It went even deeper than that. The temple area being used was the only area the Gentiles, the non-Jews, were allowed to come and worship and praise and pray to the Lord. The religious leaders weren't allowing the merchants to deal in the Jewish-only areas of the temple, just the Gentile one. And this angered Jesus because the Jewish people were supposed to be the light that guided all the nations to the glory of God. They were the ones supposed to be bringing the blessings of God to the entire world. And here they were taking away the one and only area the Gentiles had, basically ending any chance many of the Gentiles coming into the city had of discovering the glory and wonder of God, of developing a relationship with the Father. But the Jewish leaders demanded, "What are you doing? If God gave you authority to do this, show us a miraculous sign to prove it." So the Jewish leaders come out from more than likely the main temple area, meant solely for the Jewish people, and demand that Jesus perform a miracle to prove that what he did was from God, to prove to them that Jesus was a prophet of the Lord come to stir up the Jewish people to repent, like the prophets of the Old Testament had, to justify his actions to them. "All right," Jesus replied, "destroy this temple and in 3 days I will raise it up." "What?" they exclaimed. "It has taken 46 years to build this temple, and you can rebuild it in 3 days? But when Jesus said this temple, he meant his own body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered he had said this, and they believed both the scriptures and what Jesus had said. So Jesus agrees to give them their miracle, a promise to them that if they destroyed this temple, the temple of his body, then he'd raise it up again 3 days later. But see, no one understood the words of Christ. No one, not even his closest supporters, his disciples. That is, until after Jesus' death and resurrection. Then they remembered. Then they understood what he meant. Because it wasn't long after Jesus was raised from the dead and returned to the right hand of the Father in heaven that his followers understood that their bodies had become temples as well. Just as ours are to this day. If we have Jesus in our hearts, then we have the Holy Spirit dwelling inside of us. And because the Holy Spirit dwells inside of us, because God dwells inside of us, we are a living temple to his glory and majesty. A temple that shouldn't be sitting around waiting for those seeking the truth of our world to come and find us, but one that is capable of and should be going out and willing to go out to find those seeking the truth about the world. Not one waiting until someone comes to hear the gospel, but one that takes the gospel message out to those who need to hear it. See, Jesus went to the temple, went to his Father's house, not just any temple, but the temple, and found it a den of sin, cheating, lying, greed. Jesus went to his Father's house and found it being used for just about everything but its intended purpose, as a place to bring praise, worship, and honor to the Father, to grow closer to the Father. Instead, he found man's attempt to please God while feeding their own desires for earthly, worldly things. So that begs the question, what are we doing with our churches today? What are our churches focused on? I've seen so many in the same shape as this temple during Jesus' time. More concerned with earning money, with enriching themselves, more concerned with fun and entertainment, more concerned with the things of the world, the things of the flesh, the things we selfishly desire, instead of doing the selfless things the Lord desires, making sure our only concern is spreading the seeds of His word. See, by opening our doors to all, everyone, and focusing our energy on the things of His kingdom and being about the growth of His kingdom, that's how we please God over pleasing man. And that's what we're to be about. That's what Jesus wanted the people in that temple to be about. So now we're going to hop from John chapter 2 over to 1 Corinthians chapter 5 for three quick verses as Paul is pleading with the early church in Corinth to remove an unrepentant sinner from their church, a man who is dragging the rest of the church down with him. So from 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 6 through 8. Your boasting about this is terrible. Don't you realize that this sin is like a little yeast that spreads through the whole batch of dough? See, boasting normally means bragging about something. But this verse more accurately means that the Christians in the church weren't taking the sinful actions of this man seriously. That these new Christians were so used to the way that their culture in Greece normally viewed this sinful action that they waved it away like it was meaningless. And does that sound a little familiar? See, our culture today is incredibly similar. The culture of our country is so steeped, so soaked in sinfulness, that we do the same thing. We wave it away as meaningless. And this cultural rot about the truth and nature of sin, this cultural denial of sinfulness, has even leaked into many churches. Many churches claiming to follow Christ, claiming to speak on behalf of Jesus. So many churches wave away unrepentant sinfulness as meaningless. God is love. Jesus is love. They love the sinners. Jesus always hung out with the sinners and befriended sinners. But see, none of that is really the truth. It's a deceitful twist of the truth. Jesus met sinners where they were to pull them out of their sin, not join them in it, not to condone their sin. See, He didn't come to condemn sinners for their sin. He came to save them from it. And to save sinners from their sin, they need to be removed from the sinfulness they're living in and repent before the Lord. And when sin is left unchecked, when it is ignored, it spreads. Like Paul says, a little yeast, a little sin spreads through the whole batch. It infects the whole of the church. That's why the company we keep is so important. We are affected by those we surround ourselves with. So church people aren't sinless. We aren't perfect, and we can be very hypocritical. But one thing we do is we encourage each other to repent of sinfulness and to live a life where we sin less. Get rid of the old yeast by removing this wicked person from among you. Then you will be like a fresh batch of dough made without yeast, which is what you really are. Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed for us. So let us celebrate the festival, not with the old bread of wickedness and evil, but with the new bread of sincerity and truth. Removing someone from a church sounds so harsh. It sounds unloving. But enabling sinfulness isn't helping the sinner. It's only through confronting sinfulness that it can be tackled. Only taking the temptations of sinful living head on can they be overcome. Jesus didn't ignore the devil in the wilderness. He confronted the devil with the word of God. He removed the temptation from his life. He stopped it in its tracks. And the same is for sinfulness and temptation in our own lives. We must stand firm in the word of God and remove it from our path. And sometimes the most loving thing we can do to someone living in unrepented sin is remove them from our presence until they can get themselves in a right standing with the Lord and confront their own sinfulness. Because if we allow the sinfulness they bring in to spread, well, we end up like the religious leaders in Jerusalem, allowing widespread sinfulness in our temples, our churches, allowing the corruption of those coming to us in an effort to seek out the truth of God. Because what are we bringing them to? What are we showing them? We are showing them corruption. We are allowing sinfulness to trip them in their walk. Now, after our quick detour in 1 Corinthians, let's move on to the scripture our Bible video actually covered and study from Hebrews chapter 10, verses 1 through 18. The old system under the law of Moses was only a shadow, a dim preview of the good things to come. Not the good things themselves, the sacrifices under that system were repeated again and again, year after year, but they were never able to provide perfect cleansing for those who came to worship. If they could have provided perfect cleansing, the sacrifices would have stopped, for the worshipers would have been purified once and for all time, and their feelings of guilt would have disappeared, but instead those sacrifices actually reminded them of their sins year after year, for it is not possible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. The sacrificial system under the law of Moses was simply a shadow. It was a glimpse of what was to come, like seeing someone's shadow coming towards you in the late afternoon sun, stretched out way in front of them. The shadow isn't a part of the person, but instead it's kind of a sign of the person's coming. Well, that's what the law of Moses and the old covenant was for the new covenant of grace through Christ. It was a sign of what was to come. After all, as Paul states, if the sin offerings of the Jewish people, the sin offerings of the law of Moses, were the true thing and not just the shadow, then why would they need to be done again and again, year after year? After all, if they were truly effective at taking away sin, each person would have only needed to offer one sacrifice, only one for their entire lives. But that clearly wasn't the case, seeing as they had to do it year after year. That is why when Christ came into the world, he said to God, "You did not want animal sacrifices or sin offerings, but you have given me a body to offer. You were not pleased with burnt offerings or other offerings for sin. Then I said, 'Look, I have come to do your will, O God, as it is written about me in the scriptures.'" God never desired sacrifices. Yes, he commanded them, but only after the fall of Adam and Eve. God never wanted the blood of animals spilt. He wanted our hearts. As Samuel told King Saul in 1 Samuel chapter 15, verse 22, "So Samuel said, 'Has the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed than the fat of rams.'" See, God desired then and desires now our hearts, our obedience, our love, our loyalty. And that's what Jesus came to be an example of, to show us how to give the Father our heart, how to show our love for him and for those around us, and to show us how to be obedient. For he was perfectly obedient, never once missing the mark of God, never once sinning. He was perfectly loving, even to those who did nothing but reject and hate him. Now, can we be as he was? As his example to us was? No. But like a toddler trying to walk around in his father's way too big shoes, we can do our own imperfect best to emulate, to imitate Christ's perfect footsteps. First, Christ said, you did not want animal sacrifices or sin offerings or burnt offerings or other offerings for sin, nor were you pleased with them, though they are required by the law of Moses. Then he said, look, I have come to do your will. He cancels the first covenant in order to put the second into effect. Jesus is the fulfillment of the old covenant of the law. Jesus was perfectly obedient to the law in a way that no one born into the sin-tainted world could possibly be. And because of that, Jesus was the spotless, perfect Lamb of God that no other sacrifice given life in this sinful place could even begin to measure up to. For God's will was for us to be made holy by the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ, once and for all time. We spoke about this a few weeks ago, that Jesus wasn't plan B, that Jesus was the plan, the only plan the Lord had for our salvation from the beginning of time. This is the will of God, to have his son sacrificed. This was always the will, to have his son sacrificed to redeem his beloved but fallen creation. Under the old covenant, the priest stands and ministers before the altar day after day, offering the same sacrifices again and again, which can never take away sins. But our high priest offered himself to God as a single sacrifice for sins, good for all time. Then he sat down in the place of honor at God's right hand. There he waits until his enemies are humbled and made a footstool under his feet. For by that one offering he forever made perfect those who are being made holy. So while the old sacrifices would cover the sin of a person like a rug used to cover a stain in a carpet, Jesus' sacrifice scrubs the sin of that person clean away, as if no stain had ever existed. That's how powerful his gift of salvation truly is. That's how clean he scrubs those of us being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. That's how clean his blood washes us in the eyes of the Father. And the Holy Spirit also testifies that this is so. For he says, this is the new covenant I will make with my people on that day. Says the Lord, I will put my laws in their hearts, and I will write them on their minds. No longer do we need right from wrong written out for us. We have his laws placed on our hearts and written in our minds. The problem is we need to be taught how to stop ignoring them. Stop ignoring that insistent voice of the Spirit pointing us in the correct direction, warning us of the sinful behaviors we are about to engage in. Just like we need to be taught how to read, to understand physical written materials, we need to be taught how to understand the spiritual ones written into us by our ever-loving Creator, who has given us everything we need to find him and the glory of his love and blessings. If only we learn to understand and focus on the voice of the Spirit and drown out the tempting voice of our enemy, to discern what keeps us holy from what tempts us astray. Then he says, I will never again remember their sins and lawless deeds. And when sins have been forgiven, there is no need to offer any more sacrifices. We need to consider what this verse means. What does it mean when God tells us that I will never again remember their sins and lawless deeds? Well, it means that once we've been forgiven for our sins, once we've come to him in repentance and been forgiven, there is nothing we can do for God to remember our past sins. God refuses to remember our past sins. That's how great his love for us is. There isn't any more need for sacrifices because Christ's blood has washed us cleaner than new fallen snow. We are robed, clothed in his righteousness. And when in that day we come before the Father to be judged, judged by the one who is perfectly just and must punish all sin by the wages of that sin, he looks on us as he looks on his perfect lamb, as the one who paid the wages of our sin already. He looks on us as he looks on his own son. See, now, we've covered three different sets of scripture here in the main lesson, and they might seem different, talking about different things, covering different ideas, but they interconnect more than we may realize. See, Jesus came to earth to drive the sinfulness out of the temple of his Father, from the temple of the Holy Spirit, from us. He came to cleanse us of our sins so we can get back to what we were meant to do, praising and worshiping and deepening our relationship with God, with the Father. Jesus came to show us how to live for the Father, how to live for each other, how to truly love one another, how to place what is truly important before all things. And what is truly important is the eternal, is our relationship with God. So he came to show us to be loving not by condemning those living in unrepentant sin, but also not by accepting the sinfulness people are living in. He came to show us to love each other enough to pull each other out of sin, not follow the world's twisted idea of love, which is no more than really turning a blind eye to those wallowing in sin and leaving them to drown in it. Jesus came to be the fulfillment of the shadow, the old covenant, to be the embodiment of God's enduring love for his fallen creation, to be a living testament of God's great mercy, God's plan to offer us a way out of paying the wages of our sinfulness. He came to offer each of us a chance to be washed clean, cleaner than anything this stained world could ever get, and to clothe us in his own righteousness, his own perfect visage, so we become what we were always meant to be, what we were created to be, God's heirs, God's beloved children. So, how about we get up and move to a bonus song with Ms. Faith?
Yeah.
So now let's see how this week's lesson connects back to Christ. Jesus came to be the sacrifice for sin. He lived a sinless life, died on the cross, and rose from the dead. In him we have complete forgiveness once and for all. So to connect our lesson back to Christ, I want to study the crucifixion of Christ, but I want to focus mainly on one particular moment of that crucifixion. So let's finish out our study tonight with Luke chapter 23, verses 32 through 46. Two others, both criminals, were led out to be executed with him. The trial, if we can really call it that, has already occurred. Jesus has been scourged, whipped horribly, and beaten. And the people, the Jewish people, who'd been awaiting his coming for generations, but couldn't see past their own selfish desires and expectations for who the Messiah should have been in their own minds, had already demanded his execution. But Jesus wasn't the only one led out to be crucified that day. Two others were brought out with him. When they came to the place called the Skull, they nailed him to the cross, and the criminals were also crucified, one on his right and one on his left. The Romans, who were always good for some cruelty, who were often exceptionally harsh to criminals, forced the three criminals to walk themselves up the hill to be crucified, forced to carry their own crosses, their own devices of torture and death. And once they reached their destination, the three were nailed to the crosses and hung up with Jesus right in the center. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they are doing." And the soldiers gambled for his clothes by throwing dice. Even in the midst of pain, in the midst of suffering and rejection and cruelty, Jesus shows us how we are meant to act, to behave, what we are to aspire to be, and shows that as he had no sinfulness, he had no hypocrisy in him either. Jesus said to love your enemy, and that's exactly what he's doing here. Because in the midst of all this, he still seeks the face of the Father, not for himself, but for his enemies, those causing him harm. Jesus wishes for those bringing him harm to be forgiven because he understands they don't truly know what they're doing. That for all the great things he'd done, that those people weren't able to comprehend exactly who he was and why he was there. The crowd watched and the leaders scoffed. "He saved others," they said. "Let him save himself if he is really God's Messiah, the chosen one." The soldiers mocked him too by offering him a drink of sour wine. They called out to him, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." A sign was fastened above him with the words, "This is the King of the Jews." Mockery, taunting, cruelty, denial. Remember, these are people who've heard of Jesus performing miracles. Probably a good many of them witnessed these miracles before their very own eyes. And still, mockery, taunting, cruelty, and denial. You know, we Christians hear the explanation and excuse for unbelief all the time. That if only someone could see a miracle happen before their eyes, then they'd finally believe. If only we saw as many miracles today as they did during the time of the early church in the book of Acts, they finally believe. But the book of Acts takes place over many, many years. And if we spread out those miracles in that book, it ends up being about a miracle a year. And on top of that, we have this right here. People who witnessed miracles still turning from the Lord so they could remain in their sin. So they could hold on to their own selfish desires about who they want the Messiah to be and what they want the Messiah to do. People who witnessed and had been told firsthand about the miracles of Jesus, still denying him. Witnessing miracles doesn't turn people into believers. They'll always find a way to rationalize a miracle away if they've hardened their hearts. Watching miracles unfold won't turn people to Christ, because the greatest miracle we will ever witness Jesus perform is the miracle he does to our own hearts when we begin to push the world aside and follow him. And that's a miracle we only see after we've softened to him and accepted him in our lives. One of the criminals hanging beside him scoffed. "So you're the Messiah, are you? Prove it by saving yourself and us too while you're at it." Even the already condemned turn on him, begin to mock him, telling the Lord to prove himself to everyone, to please man. See, this is no different than the temptations of Satan in the wilderness. This criminal is telling Jesus to forsake the plan of God and take his life into his own hands, to forget the abundance of God and provide for himself. Temptations take all forms and shapes, but they all tend to have one through line in common: to live to please man, to please our own desires instead of living to please God. But the other criminal protested, "Don't you fear God even when you're being sentenced to die? We deserve to die for our crimes, but this man hasn't done anything wrong." You know, it's mentioned in both the accounts of Matthew and Mark that even this criminal mocked Jesus in the beginning. But at some point during the hours of suffering, he came to a realization that Christ was who he said he was. Or maybe he just came to the realization that so many of us do, that we need a savior. Either way, though, this criminal sees that Jesus is innocent. This criminal, though not living out his faith, fears God. And he actually repents. He admits that he deserves the punishment he is receiving for his crimes. And because of this, he sticks up for Jesus in front of all the people gathered to watch the crucifixion of the King of the Jews. Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And finally, this man calls on Christ for salvation. He doesn't just recognize he needs a savior, but he calls on Jesus to be his personal savior. And Jesus replied, "I assure you, today you will be with me in paradise." Today, you will be with me in paradise. Today. Not some unknown time in the future. I assure you, today you will be with me in paradise. Not hold on, let's say a special prayer first. Not hold on, we need to speak about how much you've given to the church. Not hold up, let's take a look at your works, at what you did during your life, what good deeds you can be patted on the back for, to see if you've earned paradise. Not, "Sorry, chief, you were never baptized in my name." See, none of those things, not one of those things, none of them mattered. None of them mattered to Jesus. Just faith in Christ alone for salvation. That's all it took for the criminal to hear Jesus himself assure, promise him, that the criminal would be in paradise with Jesus that very day. Our salvation doesn't come from prayers or baptism or works. It comes solely from the grace and mercy of God. The only work, so to speak, we need to do is accept Christ as our salvation, as our Savior, as our Lord, just as this criminal hanging on a cross was wise enough to do. By this time, it was about noon, and darkness fell across the whole land until 3 o'clock. The light from the sun was gone, and suddenly the curtain in the sanctuary of the temple was torn down the middle. Then Jesus shouted, "Father, I entrust my spirit into your hands." And with those words, he breathed his last. The curtain was torn. You know, this isn't a throwaway verse. It isn't something to gloss over. This is key. Been talking about this whole program, why Jesus came, things that Jesus came to earth to do. This, it may be the most important. See, Jesus came to tear that veil, that curtain, that separation from God. See, in the sanctuary of the temple in Jerusalem, before the Holy of Holies in the center, was a curtain, a veil that kept everyone separated from the presence of God, a veil that only the high priest was able to go behind once a year. Jesus tore that veil. Jesus ended the separation we had with God. He tore that veil, and now we are reunited with the Father. We are able to once again dwell in the presence of the Father. We don't need someone to intercede for us. We don't need someone to pray for us. We don't have to confess our sins to a person, to a man. We go directly to God. We have one intercessor, one person who intermediates between us and God. One, and it is no man. It is Christ, Christ alone. And all this has happened, all because of his perfect plan. God's plan to send Jesus into the world and show us how not just to live for ourselves, but to live for the betterment of others and to live in a way that honors and glorifies the Father. God's perfect plan to tear a hole through that which separated us from him and create a way for us to return to the eternal presence of the one who loved us first. A way that requires nothing from us, nothing, but faith in the one who gave everything for us, though we were yet but sinners. Nothing but faith in Christ alone. Now, let's take a few moments to praise and worship that Lord with Mr. Isaac.
Pity, love, and
Now it's time to prep yourself for the Pastor Kevin Shuffle. To your ready positions. Are you set?
Hi there, I'm Pastor Kevin. It's time for questions from kids. Nani from Milwaukee, Wisconsin asks,
sometimes I feel like God doesn't like me because I disobey him. What should I do?
Oh, that's a reasonable question. All believers at some point have felt this way. Just ask some adults around you. Now, God is not like man, and so he forgives much more readily and quickly than humans do. Now, your obedience shows you love him, but you're not saved by your obedience. You're saved by grace through faith alone. And Satan wants to deceive you. Satan wants to tell you and to trick you into thinking that it's all about you, when in reality, it's all about God. I also want you to know that our feelings can sometimes lie to us. Now, here's what I would encourage you to do. Try every day to obey him. Get up every day and say, today I want to obey God, and I want to glorify him, and I want to make him known. I also want to encourage you to read the scriptures daily to remind you of the truth. God's holy and true word reminds us of who we are, and in particular, who we are in Jesus Christ. I also want you to share these thoughts with others around you so they can continually pray for you and pray with you. Jesus Christ paid the price for all of our sins. In Jesus, you have complete forgiveness. How does this truth give you courage to live for him?
So I want to hear from you in the comments section. How does this truth give you courage to live for him? So now let's get a teacher's perspective from our globe-trotting verse guy, Mr. Jeff.
Good afternoon, boys and girls. It's Mr. Jeff once again. I'm traveling through New England and lower parts of Canada this week, and it's rather cold out. So there's your weather forecast. So this week's question is, how does the truth give you courage to live for him? So to be clear, what we're talking about is referring to Jesus freeing us from our sins. So God so loved the world, he sent his beloved and singular son to us, and he took away the sins of the world. That faith that we have, that you're learning about, that we read about in the gospel, causes us to want to please the Lord, because we want to be obedient, and we know that Christ paid it all for us. We can't atone for our sins. Even as much as we try, and I know I've tried, we just fall short. So we need to live for Christ, and we need to live as with him with us and everywhere we go and everything we do. And it gives me great courage knowing he has a place for me and you in heaven that he's preparing for, because we are following his word, his teaching, especially in the New Testament. Certainly the Old Testament sets it up, but the New Testament is where Jesus has given us the promises. Do these things, follow his guidance, be obedient to the Father. Of course, Jesus was. And that gives me great courage that I can do all things through Christ Jesus. Well, listen, time for me to get going. maybe shovel some snow. I'll see you soon. God bless you. Love you all. Bye now.
I hope everyone had a great time tonight. And let's close in prayer. Dear Lord, thank you so much for another great study, for another great night spent together worshiping and studying about and taking lessons to heart and expanding our knowledge of your word, of your love, and just of your goodness. Lord, please bless us as we go through our week. Please remind us and continue to remind us as you refill us with the Holy Spirit again and again. Remind us of just how blessed we are, how grateful we should be for your love, for your abundant and patient love, and just for just the mercy you've had on us to save us from the sinfulness that we were born into, to tear that veil, tear that separation, so that we can once again cross through by ourselves, take the hand of your Savior, the Savior you sent, the Savior in Christ alone, take his hand and allow him to pull us through into your presence. So Lord, please bless us and help us to remember these lessons and to grow closer and closer to you and desire to grow closer and closer to you each and every day. And I pray these things in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. And with that, blessings to everyone watching. And I hope to see you again next week for Tilling the Soil. Stand up and sing. We accept this offering.